Well, hello there. It's been a little while. I do apologize for that. I am okay, before anyone asks. Health is what it is, up and down like a yo-yo. But I've also been very, very busy and exciting news to share with you guys, actually. In fact, there's a couple of bits of exciting news. I'm leaving my current job as a firmware engineer, primarily on the STM32, although I do a little bit on the ESP32, but not very much at all. I'm leaving that job at the end of next week, and in 2 weeks' time, I will be starting a new job doing something very similar, firmware engineer still, but the company that I'll be working for there, they only use the ESP32. So obviously there's a clash here between my hobby, what we're doing today, and then work, and there's obviously the associated risk that then you stop enjoying your hobby. But I'm not seeing it like that at the moment, and I can't see it being like that, but won't know until we know. But that means good things for the ESP community, for you guys, because it means I'm going to be working all day on the ESP32 using the IDF. They don't use Arduino, thankfully. That sounded wrong. I'm not an Arduino hater at all. I quite like Arduino. You can do so much more with the IDF, and it's now what I'm most comfortable with anyway. I've not touched Arduino for a good number of years now. But I would still use it just for throwing something together quickly. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it. That's really exciting stuff. Now, what I've got on the screen, I'm going to try and do a slightly different format for this video based upon some feedback I got down in the comments below. Let me know if you like it or dislike it, or whether I could still tweak it, tune it, so on and so forth. I'm not going to please everyone, I appreciate that, but if I can find some sort of happy medium, and hopefully the quality average of the content improves, then that's only a good thing, really. As I say, I'm doing it for you guys. No monetization on any of this, so don't forget, I don't really care so much about the likes, but do share it up on the ESP32 Reddit and the forums and so on, if you think one of these videos is particularly relevant to a discussion. Don't just spam the link for no reason. But if you think it's going to help someone, then feel free to do so. Before we dive into the code, the final bit of news I've got is I've ordered a new toy. And this arrived yesterday. I haven't got my webcam set up at the moment. Well, I have, but not to do a decent stream here. So this is an Arduino expansion board. As you probably tell from the pin header arrangement and the size here. And it's quite a common board. It's got a variable resistor here. We've got a DHT11, so that's a temperature and humidity sensor. We've got an RGB LED. There's an infrared. There's a light dependent resistor. There's a LM35. What's that one? I forget. I think it's a temperature sensor again. Can't quite remember off the top of my head. A couple of switches. There's I2C broken out over here, and there's a couple of extra pins, serial and so on. Oh, a big buzzer. How can you miss the big buzzer? This is going to become the focus for this project. I think that's probably a good idea, and we'll write code and modules for each of the various bits and bobs on this board. Because it covers a lot of the different protocols. So we got UART, we sort of know how to do that. We're going to cover a bit more on that today. I2C, which we've not done yet. The DHT11, I think, is a one wire interface. Buzzer is going to be probably a PWM or a Sigma Delta. We've got analog reads, digital writes, and so on and so forth. So And we can do the remote control library. I'm quite keen to play about with that. For infrared stuff. Don't really have a use for it, particularly when you've got Wi-Fi and so on the board, but it might be useful to you guys. Now, what you can't see underneath this is what you would expect to be the Arduino. Now, it is an Arduino form factor board, but it doesn't have an Arduino on it. It has an ESP32, which is really, really cool. I've not actually got the photo of the bottom board. And it's also come with quite a small OLED screen as well. Unfortunately, it's just on a flyaway board, so we'll have to hook it up with flying wires and so on. But that's something I really do want to get up and running, is some sort of display. Nice and easy to do in Arduino, because you've got all the libraries. In our world, not so easy to do. I've not really found a sensible library, although I've not looked hard. Anyway, look forward to this. This is going to be really, really good fun. So let's get into the code. What am I showing you today? We're going to do a bit of a breakaway from the Wi-Fi stuff. We will be coming back to it, obviously, because it's not finished. But this is what I've been doing in my spare time when I've had a spare 10 minutes here and there, because I've not had much free time of late. So the format, I've already got this written. So the format of this video is I'm going to be going through it, highlighting things and talking about them, rather than you watching me actually write the code itself. As I say, based on a suggestion, on me a suggestion. So let me know if you do or don't like it. So the includes are pretty. Yeah, there's not really much point talking about them yet because at this point we don't know what the code is, so we don't actually know what we need to include. But this module that I've written here is a logging module. Now you can say, well, we've got ESP log, the macro provided by Espressif. Yes, we absolutely do. But there's one glaring problem with it. Well, there's one problem, and then there's some lack of functionality that I would like. The problem is it's not thread safe. And what can happen is if you've got two different threads running, and both of them are trying to output some debug at the same time, those two messages are both going to come through at the same time. Because we've got two different cores, don't forget, and that can cause issues. So we call it interleaving. So if you put hello world as a debug message in one thread, and then my name is Simon as a debug message in the other thread, you might get lucky. It might say hello world, my name is Simon, or my name is Simon, hello world. What you're more likely to see is hello my world, Simon. Yeah, something like that. I forget what I'm saying now, but the message is getting interleaved. So we know how to fix that problem already from stuff we've talked about before by using mutual exclusion, mutexes, and that's sort of what we're going to do here. The other thing that the library doesn't do, the macro doesn't do, that I would like. It's not a flaw of the library, like the interleaving of messages is, but something it doesn't do is sort of parsing the variadic arguments in a C++ way. And of course, they can't do that because it's written in C. So if we look at standard C out, for example, I don't particularly like the implementation, but where we use the two left angle brackets or triangle brackets, if you prefer. And you can just pump it an integer, you can pump it a float, a string, a C string, and so on. And it just handles it all for you. You don't have to do the printf style way of doing it, with a percent s and a percent d for an integer, a percent u, or a percent 0.2f for a floating point with two decimal precision. And it starts getting clunky. And the reason I don't particularly like that is because you end up with then a load of format strings. So if you're doing a printf, so let's just say we've got int I equals 1, and then we've got, you know, float f equals 2.3, and then we've got char star string is hello Simon, and then we wanted to printf this, or let's actually stick with the ESP. So we would do ESP log e whatever, doesn't matter, whatever your tag is. Then you need to do this format string, so it would be something like %s for a string, and then we would do int is %d, and float is %, let's do 0.2f, and then in your variadic arguments here we will put stra I and f like that. That's fine, but this starts getting clunky, and we start filling up memory, insignificant amount of memory, but it's more than none with these format strings, and I just don't like it. There's a better way. If I didn't like it and there wasn't a better way, then obviously you're stuck with it, but there is a better way. So let's get into the code then. So first of all, yeah, we're in a namespace, we're in a class, usual sort of thing here. We're going to do some type punning here. Control B. Yep, there we go. Just to make some of the types a little bit shorter, particularly useful because I've obviously got this zoomed in so you can see it on your screens a bit better if you're watching on a TV, on a Chromecast or on your phone or something, tablet. So we do the using declaration in C++. So using capital M S, so milliseconds, is standard chrono milliseconds. The old C way of doing this would be type def standard chrono milliseconds ms, like that. Have I got that the right way around? Might be the other way around. I always forget. But the using declaration is it effectively does the same thing. I don't know if it is actually different in any way. But it just shortens that, so we can just use ms for milliseconds. And this is public, so it is exposed to the outside world, but only within this login class definition. So it's not going to pollute our global namespace. So if you wanted to use this type def, you would have to scope it into the login class to get at it. So if we were out here somewhere and you wanted to declare a variable of 100 milliseconds, you couldn't just do here milliseconds t equals 100. That wouldn't work. You would have to do logging, and you would have to scope it properly, so it's not polluting our global namespace there. I'm just going to control Z all of these. Done that before. There we go. Okay, source location. This is something really, really cool. Unfortunately, it's still experimental, as you can see there, but it works really, really good. This is the C++ replacement for file, for line, for func, for these macros. That's not going to work. Line would return 27, file would return logging.h, I think with the path on it as well, off the top of my head. This just containerizes all of that, does the same thing, but it containerizes it. And the useful thing there is we can actually move an object of type source location around, and it retains its original information from the place it was constructed. That will become a little bit more obvious as why that's useful later on. We're going to use a mutex. This is going to be recursive. That'll be obvious later on. So yeah, we're going to use a recursive timed mutex, not actually used the timed one yet. And I've just done a type name alias here. This means that if we wanted in the future to change the mutex type we're using, rather than scrolling through the code and changing it each time, and every single time we reference it, we can just change it here and then use mutex T in our code. Quite common to do things like this at the top of your file. We'll specify default log level, so if the user's not supplied a default log level, then this is what it'll be. A default wait time for the mutex, so if a thread is currently writing to the log and another thread wants to start writing, then it will by default wait 100 milliseconds, and if it's still not the original thread's still not finished writing to the log, then we will fail. The second task will fail. Obviously, we can change this, but this is just a default if none other is specified. Instance level. So this class is going to be creatable or instantiatable. No, that's the wrong word. Yeah, it's the right word. So we're going to be able to create instances of this. Because, for example, in our Wi-Fi, we might want to do some logging, but we might want to not wait the full 100 milliseconds. We might want to only log errors. But then in our Bluetooth module, we might be more than happy waiting a full second. We might want to log debug and everything above. So we want to create instances of this, but that needs to play nicely with the default instance, which we'll talk about later. So here we actually define the mutex of type mutex underscore t, which we can see is a recursive time mutex. And when we use the using declaration or type def, IntelliSense does its thing and you can hover over and see what it is. So we've got a log buffer, unavoidable for one of the implementations of the logging. And I've set that size to be a maximum of a kilobyte. Well, no, it is a kilobyte. And we've got a forward declaration here of a helper class. Won't talk about this until we need it. Because this is where the clever stuff happens for a particular implementation. Took a bit of playing about with, but I think you're going to be really, really impressed. Hugely overcomplicated for what it is, but it's the only way of doing it in that way. But with that comes some complexity. But the benefit is usability. It makes this really, really nice to use. Let me just control Z all of that. There we go. We've got a default constructor, which means we are trivially constructible because everything is instantiated properly, and it's no except, which is this is the way you should do your default. I learned this from Jason Turner over at C++ Weekly fairly recently, that you should have this no except when you do equals default. So now we have some constructors. We've got three constructors in total. Let's get them all on the screen there. And usefully, they can all be const expert. This is really good because it means they can be compile time constructed, which saves a lot of runtime faff. And of course, they are all no except as well, which is really, really good. No dynamic allocations in the constructors. That they can't throw exceptions. The one key to us would be a memory alloc failure. That's the most likely one. But because we haven't got any dynamic allocations, it's not going to throw an exception. Nothing here can throw an exception. So we can mark it no except and const expert. So if we pass the constructor a log level and a mutex wait time, then we set our instance level here and we override the default level. The other one, we've got a delegated constructor here. So if we only pass it a log level, then what are we going to do? Well, we're just going to set that instance log level and leave the mutex wait time as default. And we can do a delegated constructor here because we can just call this constructor with the new level and with the default mutex wait time. Yeah, that's going to make a write of default mutex wait to something that already is default mutex wait. But don't forget, this is const expert, so realistically it doesn't make a difference. And obviously the last one here is, if we want the default level but we just want to specify a different mutex wait time, then it's very, very similar. We pass it the default level and whatever the user specified as the new wait time. So fairly straightforward there, hopefully. So let's do this bottom up and talk about the actual low level first. I don't normally do it this way around. But I've put the actual interface to the API right at the start here, because this is the thing that's going to need changing if we want to change something, most likely. So this is static, and it follows quite a similar format to what you would expect. It returns an error type. That's quite important, because if we failed to acquire the mutex, then we should inform the caller that we did not log this message. We failed to do the log the message because we timed out, as you can see there. Also, if the log level in the call was less than the default, is greater, because the way the enum works, than the default log level, then we will immediately return invalid state. There's not really a nicer predefined error message here, unfortunately. But basically, that's saying to the user, and I've explained it here, and I've actually got an error there. There we go. We're basically saying to the user, you wanted to log an information message, but our default log level is currently to only display warnings and errors. So I've not logged this because it's an information message. It's not important enough. Now note that this is static, so we have to use the default log level because that is static. We can't use this instance variable here. That's going to be quite important. So that means it's comparing against the default, obviously. We also take in a standard string view. I've chosen to use the standard library for this. Basically, it plays nicely with standard strings. I don't particularly have a big problem with standard strings if they're used carefully. But also, this works perfectly well with const char stars and various other different standard library things as well. For example, streams that we will see later on. And finally, we've got this source location, and we can see it's defaulted, so it's an optional parameter. And this is where source location is really, really clever. So you would say source, so if we do not pass it a source location, it's going to be created in this call here by calling, well, the constructor of source location and getting current. That's all defined in the standard library. And you would think that the line number associated with this construction is line number 90 in file logging.h in function log, but you'd be wrong. It's not. It's really, really clever. It actually extracts the line, the function, and the file from the caller. So if we call this in our Wi-Fi, for example, and in Wi-Fi we call log ESP log is it level debug? No, it's just log debug, isn't it? Log debug. We do hello world. Something like that. Then source location, even though it's clearly in this file on that line, will actually be wi-fi.cpp, line 38, and in the constructor. Constructor, that was a bad example. Oh well. But say we put it in the event handler, the function would be event handler. Really, really clever stuff. Or, of course, we can actually pass in an object. So we could create this somewhere else. So we could say, let's give a good example. Let's say we want to create a source location here, X, let's call it. We could then pass that to the Wi-Fi event handler and then do our log in here. Log, I'm not going to write it all out. Hello. And then put X there. And X now, because we're not using the defaulted argument, we've passed it in, will actually say line 42 in function event handler in wi-fi.cpp. Obviously, we would have to pass this in as an argument here somewhere. And you see what I mean, though? Oops. Oh, no. Oh, I've just changed my zoom. Didn't mean to do that. Apologies. Oh, what have I done now? There we go. Cool. Okay. So, with a timed mutex, we can call the function. So, unfortunately, we can't do RAII on this. So, what we've seen before is we would do standard lock guard. Is it standard lock guard? I forget. Of mutex type, lock, like that, oh, probably spelt correctly, like that. And this would mean the execution will not pass this point until we've acquired the lock, and then when we exit the scope, or in this case the function, then this will be released. You can't do that for a timed mutex, because if we did not get the mutex in the required amount of time, where do we go? We can't progress, because that implies we got the mutex. This doesn't return anything because it's a constructor, so it just returns the object. So we can't do that here. So we have to do it the slightly more old-fashioned way of a get, a take, and then a release, or a give, should I say. But here we can actually try the lock for a period of time. And here, of course, we're using the default mutex wait time here. If this returns true, then it means we acquired the lock. If it returns false, it means we timed out. And you can see that's exactly how I've implemented it here. So if we do get the lock, then we can call our logging function. We'll talk about this in a minute. Release the lock and then return OK. So what is our log message going to look like? Well, we'll use ESP log level, which allows us to specify rather than ESP log D, for example, ESP log D would be tag and then hello. Something like that. But what this actually is let's just do some copy and paste. ESP log debug tag hello, like that. Something like that. You see what I mean? Obviously, quotes and commas and so on there. So, log level is just a slightly lower level macro call. So we give it the level. The first thing that's going to be printed out then, after the default things that ESP log does, for example, the time, is location, so from source location, file name. That's really good. That's pretty much the first thing we want to see is where did this, which file did this debug message originate from? Then we have one formatting string here. That's all we need. So no more different formats for different modules, and then you change the way you want to structure it, you know, in a couple of months' time, and then you've got to go back and change all the other ones because things don't look the same, so on and so forth. It starts getting really difficult to maintain. We have one definition. That's it, which is really, really nice. So in square brackets after the file name, we are going to have, oops, percent %d, so an integer. Oh, go away, IntelliSync. Percent %d, it's an integer, and we can see the first parameter is the line number, a colon, and then a string. The string is then the function name that this refers to. So this means when you look at the log message, straight away you know the file. You can go straight to the line number with, is it Control L? I know that works in Eclipse. No, I don't know what the key combination is in VS Code. You can go straight to the line number or straight to the function if it's just at a glance, because typically we don't remember what line number's what, but you got the function there as well. A colon, a space, and then percent dot star s. This is normal printf notation. Basically saying we have a string, const char star, but we are going to tell you how long that string is. So that means it doesn't need to be null terminated. So it's not going to be intelligently done. And that's quite important. It stops us, or it reduces the likelihood of a buffer overrun because we have forgot to null terminate a string, for example, and gets rid of some of the nastiness associated with C strings, with needing that null termination. And because we're passing in a string view which knows the length of the string inside already, whether that's come from a standard string or a char array, which is quite useful because that means then you don't need the null terminator if it's an array, if you know the length. So we pass it the length and then the data. And what this will do is it will print out this number of characters starting from this location. And that's it. We don't need to worry about null then. So that's our log function. Really, really simple, straightforward. And this can be implicit. So if we pass in a standard string rather than a string view, then it will convert it to a string view in the call. If we pass it a char star, it'll do that as well. But we're going to do some more clever stuff than that. Okay. This video is going to end up being two parts, I think. So what if we want to log this in a sort of standard cout way, sort of a printf way, where rather than passing it a string view, say take that example where we've got int I is 1 and we've got float float f is 2.0 whatever, and we want to print those out. So we want to do a log of a level, you know, debug sudo code here, and we want print out the value I. Well, I isn't a string view here, and neither is f. So we can't call this because there's no way to implicitly convert from an integer or a float or whatever it is into a string. Now you can do this with cout. So we can do standard cout I f. That works. Cout can implicitly convert. So it would be nice if we can do that as well. Save that. So this is where our VariAddict template's going to have to come in. So we've got a template of type name with the ellipsis, which means we're going to have multiple types and they could all be different. We're going to use the standard log, not standard log, wrong terminology. We're going to use our log function, but as an override. So it'll work out whether or not we mean this one or this one based on what we give it. We're going to pass in the level, and then we're going to pass our arguments. And this is, again, with the ellipsis, which means that this can be a variable length. But how do we now convert these parameters, this int I and this float f, into some sort of string? Well, this is where our clever bit happens. We can use that functionality from cout, or what cout uses, to do that. And that is by using an output string stream. And this is really, really cool. So we declare one of these, and then we're going to call some function, which we've not seen yet, which is going to convert all of these arguments and put them into this string stream, which then would see out would then actually write to your standard output. So UART in this case, our logging UART. But what we can do with the string stream is, funnily enough, we can get a string view from it. So we can then call our original logging function with the contents of the string stream. And it's all the conversions done for us. Clever stuff happens here. So let's have a look at what this function does. So this is private because there's no necessity for anyone outside of this class to use this functionality. So this is a sort of a good way of using templates here, or at least I think it is. So we're going to call this function with an unknown number of parameters. Let's assume it's more than one. For now. So we've got two different definitions here. One is a template that just takes one parameter, and one is a template that takes one plus a variable number. So because we're calling it with more than one in this example, we're going to be calling this function. It's going to return a standard outstream if we wanted to use that. It's going to take in, to disable these pop-ups, they're driving me mad. It's going to take in the stream as a reference, and we can just do ostream for that. It doesn't really matter whether it's a string stream or not for this. It's going to take in the first argument by reference and take in the rest of the argument. Now you might think, well, why don't we just take in all the arguments and do away with this? Because we need a way of extracting this first one. And this does that. It pulls the first parameter and then puts the rest into a parameter pack, it's called. So what we can do now is something quite clever. If we look at this function, this is the function that takes just one parameter, one argument. And what it does is, using the standard cout type notation here, is it pushes that argument into the stream and then adds a delimiter, which in our case is just a space. That's what I wanted. But this will only get called if there is only one argument left. So what does this clever bit do? What we're doing here is, remember, we sort of read right to left, sort of, is we call args to stream with this first parameter. So that means it's going to call this function, and it's going to push that first parameter into the stream. this then returns the stream and becomes the first argument to this call, which is recursive. It's calling itself here. And then the rest of the arguments. If there's only one more argument, so we only gave it an int and a float, for example, this argument, there's only going to be one. So therefore, this call will now call this function with the stream that has already got the first argument in it. It's going to append what is now the second argument to that and return, which then will return here. And that's it. Done. If there's more than one argument left, so we've already got our int I, but we've still got float f and a char star hello world, we've got more than one argument. So that means it can only call this implementation. Now float f becomes this one, and our const char star hello world is the rest, and we repeat the process. We append float f by calling this with that argument there, and then we call again with the char star. There's no more arguments left, so it calls this implementation, so now it appends the char star hello world. I hope I've explained that well. It gets a bit messy. Hope that made sense. Where are we? And that's all it does. Simple as that. And if we wanted to, we could sort of inline this. It doesn't really matter, but we could just do that. But personally, there's nothing really to be gained by doing that. I think it looks a little bit messy. So I think this looks a little bit cleaner. All right, we're ignoring the return argument because we don't really want this as an O stream. We want it as an O string stream so we can do this dot string call on it. In fact, actually, yeah, what I just showed you wouldn't work because it's not an O string stream that this returns. O string stream inherits from O stream. Gosh, hard to say all of that. So now we have a variadic implementation of this where we can pass it ints and floats, and it will just try and put it onto put it into the string that we log. Now you should hopefully get a compile time error if we try and put something into the stream that, in fact, we will get a compile time error if we try and put something into the stream that cannot be implicitly converted. So if we go back down to here, say we tried to do log whatever our level is, and then we tried to give it let's say a Wi-Fi object, my Wi-Fi. So it's some object of instance Wi-Fi. If we then try and print this, we'll log this, what's going to happen? Well, we're going to end up calling args to stream. There's only one parameter here, so it will be this implementation. So the type will be of type Wi-Fi. And what we're doing here is we're trying to call the double left shift operator on stream with an argument of type Wi-Fi. No overload, that won't work. There's no, in the implementation of this in the standard library, it doesn't know how to convert from type Wi-Fi to a stream or to a streamable object. So this will fail, and because it's a type name, because this type is obviously figured out at compile time, you will get a compile time error, and it will say you can't log this. I don't know how to do it. So that's good. We will get a compile time error rather than a runtime and it just crapping out and breaking. So that's how we handle the sort of safety side of things, of even though this will take any type, actually the underlying calls and everything, when they are deduced at compile time, it does the handling of whether or not it's something you should do or can't do. Okay, what else have we got? Logf. It would be nice if for those rare occasions, and inevitably they will happen, where we actually want to log a message in a printf type way. For whatever reason, don't know, but it's going to happen at some point. So we want to be able to do that. And this is special because the first parameter will be a format parameter. This has to have a different name. This can't just be log, because if we looked at the previous implementation, what if the first argument was hello world? How would we differentiate that from just being I wanted to log hello world to I want to log something, here's the format string, and then here's the arguments that you need to put into that format string. So that's why it's had to have a different name. There may well be a way of doing the overload with some clever enable ifs and so on, but the template deduction gets quite tricky and difficult, and I don't like it. So it's just easier to do it this way. So because we're doing a format type thing, and we're in C++ 17, so we don't have the new format library yet, and I didn't want to pull in the open source version of it. I wanted to keep things as simple as possible. We're going to use printf or snprintf. So this is where we need the log buffer created on the stack. So we create a buffer. Remember, this is 1024 long, so a kilobyte maximum. And then we just printf into that buffer using the format, using the variadic number of arguments. And this will unfold at compile time and tell you, again, if you're trying to put something in that's wrong. So you're trying to put a float into an integer format or something like that, that can't, a bad example, but something that can't be implicitly converted. And then once we've got that buffer, we can then just log it the way we normally do. Because it's now just a char star, and we know how to print a char star using our function we've just talked about. Now, there is some other funky stuff going on here that I've not talked about. So there's two functions here that look very, very similar, bar this template parameter. What I've just described is actually this version. So we call log with this buffer that we've just constructed and printf to. And then the final argument, that's the source location, we're not going to specify that. So it's going to be default constructed from where the caller is. So that is this implementation we just talked about. But what if the caller wanted to pass a source location? So like we showed in the Wi-Fi, you might construct the source location up here in the event handler, and that's where you want the line and the function and so on to be referenced to, but you actually do the logging call somewhere down here. Don't really know why you would do that, but it's something that you might want to do, so let's factor it in. How can we know whether or not the last argument in this parameter pack is a source location, or whether no source location was passed in and the last argument is a float or whatever? How do we differentiate? So we need a way of getting the last argument. And there's not actually a way of doing that. in the standard library. We can use the standard library to make our own way of doing it, but there's no get last arg, for example. So we have to do that ourselves. And that's where this really horrible, I really don't like it, but it does work, unfortunately. This standard enable if comes in. And this is actually an optional second parameter, or final parameter, should I say, to a template. So this is just type name dot 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 args, as we've normally seen. There is no second type. This is special. What this is saying is, here's the template, but this template is only valid if this condition equals true. Okay. And conversely, this is only valid if this expression equals true. Okay, but you might say, well, what's the difference between the two? It's subtle, yes. It's that exclamation mark there. So let's talk through it. So we're saying enable this template if is the same value, the last argument, and source location. So if the last argument, and we've not talked about how this works yet, but if the type of the last argument is the same as the type source location, which remember is standard experimental source location, then this returns true. Therefore, this template is enabled and valid. And we know this at compile time. If the last argument is not a source location, then this is false. Therefore, this gets deleted effectively. So when the compiler is looking, which version of this template did you mean to call? Right, check. Source location is not the final parameter. Therefore, disable this template. It cannot be this template for this call. I've got to look somewhere else. So where's it going to look? Well, the only other declaration we've got of this function is here. And it's basically the inverse. So standard enable if is the same. Get the last parameter. If the type of the last parameter is the source location, this returns true. We then not it, invert it, so now true becomes false, and enable based upon that. So basically, if the last argument is not of type source location, then this template becomes true, or becomes available for the compiler to use. So that's how we do it. Right, let's do okay, what time are we on? 53. Alrighty, this took some playing about with on Compiler Explorer on Godbolt to get this to work, and lots of forums and shouting and not quite understanding why that isn't a double equals. I really don't like this. There's far too many angly brackets and so on. I'd like to be able to write a function, a compile time function, that just returns true or false, and then pass that as the second argument template, but you can't really do that. Might be able to do it in C++ 20 with const eval. But I don't think you can do it here. But let me know in the comments if you can, if I've overlooked something there. So what do we do? Right. Let's just quickly cover off the last two ways we can call our logging, and then we'll jump back into how this is done, how we get the last parameter from a pack, because that's really clever and quite interesting. And then that'll be it for this episode. And then the next episode will be a lot shorter, and it's pretty much just overloads and running and stuff, I think. So we might want to log a buffer as hex. That's quite useful to do. And that uses the esplog buffer hex macro. You can look that up on the IDF. It just dumps out a load of bytes as hex, and that's it. So we've got a special call for that. It takes in a buffer. Doesn't matter what the type is, because we're going to interpret it as bytes, and then the length of the buffer in bytes. So we've got the nasty void star here, but actually in this case it's valid to do it because we are actually wanting to log what the bytes are. So as usual, we've got a normal comparison, make sure the login level's correct and so on, so we can turn things off. We check to make sure buff isn't a null pointer and that the length isn't zero, otherwise it makes no sense. And then we try and get the lock, and we just call the macro, simple as that. The other one that's very similar is to do a hex dump, and hex dump is it's very common in programming. This output's very similar to the previous one, but it formats it nicely, and it also gives us the ASCII representation on the right hand side. If you're familiar with hex dumps, you'll know exactly what this does. If not, just do a quick Google hex dump and you'll see that it's really nicely formatted, so you can look at memory quite nicely. And it's very, very similar. We'll pass it in a buffer and a length and so on, and that's that. The last thing, and I still umming and ahhing about this, is an operator overload to the bracket operator. This basically means that if we create an instance, so remember this class is called logging, so we create an instance of this, say my log. If we then wanted to log hello world, we would have to do my log dot log whatever the level is, and then hello world like that. And clearly we're calling log because we're calling it on object my log, so it just gets a bit messy. So by overriding the bracket operator, that means this is valid. Like that. We can directly call the object. Looks a bit weird, doesn't it? Because you normally only see this in a constructor. What this is saying is call this object's bracket operator as if it were a function. And that then causes this to fire. And basically, it does exactly what we expect. It just forwards your arguments, level, message, and location. It means we could do an overload for a hex dump and so on, and for all the variadic stuff. But that could get quite messy quite quickly. So I've decided not to do that. I might come back and change my mind and put one in for the variadic. That might be quite useful to do. So if we wanted to do a variadic thing here, so we wanted to do hello world, I and f, remembering int I and float f are whatever they are. Put some in just so it's a bit less confusing, like that. This won't work. Oh, well, this will. We know this will, but this won't. Oops. Because what we've got here is we're calling the bracket operator with a level. Yeah, that's fine. And the second parameter is string view. Yeah, that's fine because that can be implicitly converted. Third parameter, which is optional, source location, we've just given it an int. No, that won't work. So I would have to write an overload to do that. I've not done that yet. We'll see. You'll see why this is actually quite nice probably at the end of this video where we actually create this object in global namespace. So I said we're going to come back and go over this cleverness, so how we get the last type so we can compare it against whether or not it's the same as a source location type. So let's F12 down to that. So this is a class. It's a templated class that can have a variadic number of optional arguments, should I say. What happens when this class is called? Okay. Well, we're calling getLast, aren't we? We're calling the constructor. So this is constExpr because we can do all of this at compile time. What are we going to do? Well, the constructor takes the variadic number of arguments, which could be arVal references, and it constructs value with last value, and we pass in the arguments. So last value, constExpr takes in template with one type there, and then a pack of unknown number of other types. We've seen something similar to this before, haven't we? Where we unpack something by extracting the first argument and then the rest. And you'll notice this is again recursive. So we drop the val because we're not interested in the first value. We only care about the last one. And then we call ourselves again with vals. So now the second value becomes the first. And then so on, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, until we get to our very last one. And this is no longer valid because we've got our last value and the rest. Well, there is no rest. So this is where this gets called. And the last value sets val, or sorry, returns val, which is of type whatever that was. Really, really clever bit of way of unfolding. Remember, this is recursive and so on, so you might think, oh no, that's really, really bad, but this is compile time. There's no runtime cost to this. It would be nice for this to be const eval, but we don't have access to that. So now, value, which is of type, cleverly named, you'll see why, then get set to whatever that last value was. So what is type? This is interesting. So it's type name, first of all, because we're saying we're using an expression to declare what the type name is. We're using decal type, and then we're using what's called a fold expression over a comma operator. And this basically unfolds the entire parameter pack until it gets to the very last one and then extracts the type. Looks complicated, but sort of simple and elegant at the same time. And it extracts the type out of that. And then we just use our using to just get a reference to that. So now we have in this object, we have given it, in the constructor, a variadic number of arguments, and we now have the very last arguments, type, and value. Now, why did I call this type? That looks really, really nasty, doesn't it? Calling a type name a type. It's so we can do, where is it? That. So we can call this at compile time and then just get the type. Okay, yeah, I could have given it a different name. This could be whatever you want it to be, but would have to then be reflected in, where are we? Here, you would have to change this. But type is what the C library uses, C++ library, hence how we can see it here. So I wanted to keep things the same. And that's it. So that's really, really clever. Have a look through it. Have a play about with it on Godbolt, on Compiler Explorer and stuff. And it's quite useful. In Python, it's really easy to do this because you can get the length of the parameter pack and then basically use an array as you would normally reference an array to get the last element. And the well, you can get the type in Python, but you don't normally care. But in C++, it's a little bit trickier. But this is all compile sign. This is all marked constexpr, and it should all be constexpr because it can all be done at compile time. But more importantly, you could create an instance of this at runtime, but you would have no real need to. And the only place we're using it, and remember that it's private, so no one else can use it, is in this template here. This is the only place we use that. And templates have to be deduced at compile time. So that means this only happens at compile time. So it's, you know, it will add a little bit of overhead at compile time, yeah, but realistically not very much. So the last thing I want to talk about is the global side of things. And then we'll leave the rest. There's some other bits and bobs in here. In fact, yeah, I'll tell you what. No, we can cover that. It's going to take 2 minutes. So I've basically put a load of... Oh, I've done the variadic overload. Oh, I've lied to you. So yeah, here's the operator overload we talked about, where you can just call the object. I did do the templated one as well, and that's what it looks like. So again, if we call log with a level, if we call the object with a level and then some other number of arguments, and it is not this one, then we'll pass it to our variadic log function. There we are. And the rest are just basically little helpers. So if we wanted to log an error, I don't want to call log and then ESP log level error. And then if I want to do a warning, call log with ESP log warn and so on in my user code, I might just want to call log.error. And basically then that's all it does here. It then calls log with the corrects. Enum in here. Same for the printf sort of style version here. Again, error f. And it just puts in this for us. It means we don't have to copy and paste this over and over and over again. And similar for warning. Warning f. Info. Info variadic. Info f. Debug. Debug variadic. Debugger, and finally verbose, which I don't think anyone ever uses. I think I've used it once, actually, so that's a lie. Verbose variadic and verbose f. These are all just going to get inlined immediately, by the way, by the compiler, because this is, as you will have noticed, a header-only library. Needs to be, because of all the templates, to be honest. So we've talked about that. Oh, the lock. Actually, yes, let's just very briefly talk about this. Say in your user code you want to log a bunch of messages, but you don't have access to all the data at the same time, or you want to put things on different lines, but sequentially. But you don't want another task putting something in the middle between lines. What you can do, and what I've done here, and this is public, is you can actually get the lock that we use for the logging. So the caller has to give it a unique lock because it can't be shared. There's only one of them. It's going to pass it a default constructed unique lock, and then if they want to, a timeout. And that's where we've used this milliseconds 100. If it's not, I should change that to default wait time. Yeah. So we're going to try that. If we acquire the lock, then we will move the lock to this. And remember, it's by reference here. So now the caller has the lock. So that means if someone else comes along and tries to do a log message, they try the lock, they're not going to get it. They're not going to get it until this unique lock, which has been moved, because you can only move a unique lock, you can't create a copy of it. When this caller, whoever called this, deconstructs this lock, i.e. when it goes out of scope. That might be wrong. I need to check that. I think that line shouldn't be there. I'm pretty sure that line shouldn't be there. Can't remember. Let me go back and check that. Anyway, blah, blah, blah. And then there's just another way of doing it as well, where we just use the default time. So that'll be useful. But we'll sort of come back to this, sort of, when we actually use it. Of course, we had a static, so we have to do that. Normally, you would do that in the CPP file, but because this is header only and because of the templates, that would get difficult to do. So the way we do it is by using this inline specifier. Now normally you only actually see this in a class, like in a function. So inline static, and really that is superfluous. You don't need to do that, because most header files get inlined anyway. Header file declared functions or methods get inlined anyway normally. And the compiler will just ignore it. But where it doesn't get ignored is when we're outside the scope of the class. So here, this expression here would normally be in a CPP file, but it's not, it's in the header. So what if our non-volatile includes this header and our Wi-Fi includes this header? We're going to end up with two of these. And that's bad, you don't want two mutexes. So what the inline specifier means here, not specifier, is it? Forget the name. Is it means no matter how many times this logging.h is included, only create one of these. And it's as simple as that, actually. Now we exit out of namespace logging. So now we are in the global namespace and we create an instance of our class and we call it in capitals log. So that means we now have a default constructed logging function. So in our wifi.h, for example, we can include, oh, I've already done it, we can include logging.h and ignore that line. Then in our CPP, we can just use, ignore that, log.log. But we've overloaded the brackets operator, so we can just do that. Log. Hey, it works. That's really, really good. I'm really, really, really pleased with this. And of course, because this is default constructed, it's going to be using the default log level, which is info, and the default mutex wait time. I've spelt wrong. Nice. But what if actually in Wi-Fi we want to have a bit more granular control, because these are comps, we can't change these. But say we've finished with Wi-Fi now, we don't need to log everything in Wi-Fi, we know it works, it's all good. I want to park it, I want to clean up my log because I want to work on something else, and only really care about errors and warnings. Well, that's where we can then create an instance of the log in our Wi-Fi class. And then if we go whoop, to the top, we go here, and we can say ESP log warn. Because remember, the constructor can take a level. And we might say, actually, and I don't want it to sit there waiting 100 milliseconds each time. Actually, for a warning or an error in Wi-Fi, I might really want to know about that. So I might want to do 1,000 milliseconds. So we can do that. And now, rather than calling the global instance, which can be called from statics and so on, we can call our instance, which is log, lowercase. And remember, we don't necessarily need .log because we've overloaded it. And now this will go through exactly the same code, but this time only log it if it's a warning or worse, so warning or an error. And it will now actually wait for up to a second to get the mutex. So we've got more granular control now in our various objects. That's it. Really looking forward to actually using this. We'll go back to the Wi-Fi, do some stuff. Remember, I've got this new sensor board, so we'll be able to play with that. We'll get that up and running. Very much hope you enjoyed. Usual thing, comments down below. This is currently on a different branch. So this video is going to go up before I've sorted out the merging and so on into the main branch. So this is on my future branch, where you can get sort of sneak peeks into what I'm playing with. So bear with me. There won't be a GitHub link to this yet, but you can go into the GitHub from one of the other videos, swap branches, and you can see it that way, because I do need to actually do some testing of this. It compiles fine, but I've not done thorough testing of it yet, just to make sure it all works. So hope that's exciting for you. This video went on far too long, but hopefully it's shorter than it would have been if I was punching the keyboard. See you next time. Cheers, guys. Bye.